Hello, welcome to Y webinar number 4, using the discrete Laplace method to compute a Y profile match probability. My name is Mikkel Andersen, I'm from Aalborg University in Denmark. This webinar series is joint work together with David Balding from University of Melbourne in Australia. This talk is number 4 in a series on forensic evaluation of Y profile evidence. The method here complements our new method introduced in Y webinar number 1. So we recommend that you watch that one first, and that approach is based on estimating the number of males whose Y profile matches that of an alleged contributor. In this talk, we discuss the discrete Laplace method, and we recommend that to compute match probabilities when the mutation rate is low. Here, I'm first going to describe the discrete Laplace method, and then I'm going to explain how to use the software that accompany it. The work on discrete Laplace is done together with Paul Svante Eriksen from Aalborg University in Denmark and Nils Morling from University of Copenhagen back in 2013. And all the references that I mentioned in this talk will be given in the final slide, so you can find that one, all the references there. So the software that can be used to actually compute this discrete Laplace method is available in the DiskLabMix R package, and that is available on CRAN, meaning that you can install it by using this R command that is written here, and you only need to install it once and then you can use it afterwards. And I'm going to get back to this later, how to actually use the software package. The source code is available on GitHub at this link here, and there's also online documentation and installation instructions available at this link here. Please notice that the output of the program is numerical. So the figures that I show today is some external functions that I wrote, and that's not the main focus on the talk. And as I mentioned before, the references to papers are available on the last slide. So the motivation for the discrete Laplace method is that database counts, using those as Y profile frequencies is not good enough. And there are several reasons for that. For example, because most profiles are not observed in a given database. There are many, many singletons and many, many that are not observed at all. So that gives some gross fluctuations in the database counts. Also, a 20 locus Y profile lie in a 20 dimensional space, but there's strong dependence between the loci. And there's no sort of easy way to achieve a dimension reduction by using simple techniques. What is valuable to note is that sets of related Y profiles, they actually trace back in time to a common ancestor. And descendants from that ancestor, profiles of these descendants, they mutate independently at the different loci. So the method is built up on these observations. So the idea here is to use Y profiles in a population, and we then estimate a small number of ancestors and their profiles, and then assume that the mutations has happened independently, and then model these using discrete Laplace distributions. And I'll get back to that a bit later on. So we need to notice, of course, that we can trace all profiles back to a single ancestor if we go enough generations back. And what we do here is to make an approximation going not that many generations back, but going fewer back, and then have a small set of ancestors instead. And given this ancestor profile, we assume that the probability distribution for a descendant profile is given by a simple one parameter distribution, namely the discrete Laplace distribution. And again, that's motivated by the fact that the mutations happen independently across the loci. So in this talk, we will focus on this small German database. And it's some data that is available by this PERPS publication that, again, I provide the details in the final slide. There are almost 1,700 YSTR profiles on 21 loci. And I'll show you some R code later on how to load this data in. In this small example, I will just focus on this DYS19 locus and DYS392 locus. And the tiles here, or the small rectangles, are colored by the database frequency. So DYS19 allele 14 and DYS392 allele 13 is the most common haplotype in this two locus haplotypes database. And you see here that it's observed actually approximately 30% of the times. And then there's some scattered around here. So for example, haplotype 14,11 is also pretty common. And for example, haplotype 15,10 is not observed at all, that's white. And also haplotype 14 and 9 is not observed. There are some singletons in this data set as well. So those are marked with a cross. So 14,8 is a singleton, for example. So this is one way to show two locus haplotypes. This, of course, is not possible when we get to more loci, but for two locus haplotypes, this is possible. Notice, for example, that there are no observations in 15 and 10. So that's a comment over here. And that may be seem a bit strange, because the 15,11 is actually observed, and it's not just observed, it's actually observed multiple times. So we actually would expect that 15 and 10 would also exist in the population, because some of these would probably have mutated to allele 11 to allele 10 at some point, but they were not observed amongst these 1700 profiles, but we would expect them to be available in the population. And this is one of the reasons that using the database count as frequency estimation is not sufficient. This is also true for haplotype 1212 that we see over here, but not as much as this one here. We also notice, for example, that this singleton at 14,8 here. So there's the intermediate haplotype 14,9 is not observed here, but we would also expect that to actually exist in the population. We just haven't seen it yet in this database, but we expect it to happen. So we actually want an estimator here, the discrete Laplace method, being able to also give these unobserved haplotypes some probability so that we can use these in calculations. So a discrete Laplace method, that's a statistical model. And to fit or to estimate the parameters of the model, we first need to decide on a number of ancestors. And I'll demonstrate that in computer code in a few slides. So we need to determine the number of ancestors. And what is actually being done is to fit a model for one ancestor, two ancestors, and so on up to, for example, 10 or 30. And then given a number of ancestors, we need to estimate the profiles of these ancestors, but also the fraction of the population that descends from each ancestor. When we have the number of ancestors and the profiles, we also need to estimate the discrete Laplace parameters. And these implicitly reflects the mutation rate at each locus and also the number of generations between this ancestor. These two numbers cannot directly be inferred from the discrete Laplace dispersion parameters, but it's information that is a part of this dispersion parameter. Using these model assumptions, namely that the mutations happened independently across loci, given the ancestor profile, enables us to actually compute profile probability. And we can actually do it accurately, even for profiles that have never been observed. And this accuracy comes from the fact that this model, we impose assumptions that reflects the genetic processes underneath. And we are actually obtaining a huge gain in power by having these assumptions. And because we combine lots of loci, it doesn't matter if the model is not highly accurate for just one locus. Overall, we gain some accuracy. So if we continue our brief example from before, the German database based on only two loci, then we would imagine first a discrete Laplace model with one ancestor. And if we are to estimate that profile, then we would take the profile to be 14, 13, because that's the allele of highest frequency at each locus. So given this ancestor allele, we actually estimate discrete Laplace parameters for each locus. And I'm not going to show you how that would look like. But the discrete Laplace distribution, I'll get back to that a bit later, looks like a geometric distribution, just mirrored so that it also can take negative values. But it has exponential decay. So from the ancestor allele, we would expect the frequencies to actually get lower and lower. And you see here that 11 actually, so it comes lower at allele 12 here, but then it gets higher again at allele 11. So it doesn't fit that well with just one ancestor. So we actually can see from this data that we need more ancestors. And the way that proceeds, I'm not going into details with, but the idea is that we decide on a number of ancestors, and then the method tries to locate these ancestors. So there would be an ancestor here probably, but also one here maybe, and others. And I'll get back to that and show you how that actually works. Please notice that all the statistical details are available in this publication that I also provide the more details for in the final slide. So again, once we have the ancestral haplotypes, we model the descendant profiles using these discrete Laplace distributions at each locus, where we center them around the ancestor allele. Also notice that we do not know which ancestor the descendant originates from. So we actually take all the ancestors and make the descendant able to descend from all the ancestors and then weight the contributions accordingly. So in statistical terms, we can write up the model in this format. So we have a mixture distribution between the C ancestors. And this tau j here is the a priori probability of originating from the jth ancestor. So conditional on originating from the jth ancestor, all the loci are independent, and this xk here is evaluated in the ancestral alleles, so they're called mu here, with the dispersion parameter called theta here. So the jth ancestor on the kth locus. And we look in the discrete Laplace distribution. So that distribution has this formula. So the theta to power absolute value of x minus mu here gives the exponential decay. And that factor here is the normalization constant, meaning that we actually sum to one. So the central point here is that given the ancestor, the loci have mutated away from the ancestor allele independently. That's the central assumption of this method, which we also believe is true in the genetic world. So when we have fitted a DL discrete Laplace model for a database, we will normally compare the empirical and the fitted profile probabilities. And it could be, for example, to see if there are database errors. There are some times where there actually are typos or wrong alleles registered. And that's, of course, you want to try to catch that, and the discrete Laplace method can actually help you catch that. And again, notice that it is important that the database is representative of the population. So to the right-hand side here, I show a discrete Laplace model for the German data on these two loci. And this is a model with 9 ancestors. And you see here on the first axis here, we have the predicted probabilities using the discrete Laplace model with 9 ancestors. And we compare that to the observed frequencies in the database. And you see here that there are number of haplotypes here, these are the singletons in the database. So in the database counts, they have the same frequency. So one divided by almost 1700. Whereas under the discrete Laplace model, these haplotypes has actually quite a different frequency. We see that especially for the rare haplotypes here, so the singletons, the discrete Laplace model gives different probabilities. But if we go up to the more frequent haplotypes, the model actually pick them up, and the result of the model is more or less the database frequency, which actually makes sense. So if we focus on two different singletons, so I focus on this singleton down here, 14.8 and 16.14. These two are singletons that behave a bit differently. So this 14 and 8 is the one we have here. Using the database frequency, it has this frequency, exactly the same as this 16.14 here, but they have very different estimated probabilities under the discrete Laplace. Whereas this 14.8 is pretty rare, or the model thinks it's pretty rare, as opposed to 16.14 that is a lot more common. And if we look at the data, that actually makes sense. So this 16.14 here is closer to some more frequent haplotypes, whereas this 14.8 is almost by itself. So it actually makes sense that discrete Laplace think that this profile is a lot more rare in the population as well. So if we the points here, they're colored depending on how much the discrete Laplace probability, how much different it is from the observed probability. So blue colors here mean that the discrete Laplace distribution or method actually gives higher frequencies to the profiles than they were if we use the database counts. And red ones means that they get lower probabilities. So all the points to the above the line here, so that's the identity line, y equals x, or the when the predicted under the discrete Laplace equals the database frequency. So they are red above the line and blue below the line here. And you can see here, these haplotypes are colored. So the singletons, the red singletons around here, all of these are above the line. So they actually are more rare under the discrete Laplace model than they were if we used the database counts as frequencies. And there are a few haplotypes. There's one singleton, two singletons, and then some other profiles that is that the discrete Laplace model think is a bit more rare than the database would say. The gray colors here means that the profiles were not observed in the database. The white one here means that the discrete Laplace and the database almost gives the same probability. So you see here that a lot of the common haplotypes, they are actually white here, meaning that the discrete Laplace agrees with the database counts. Okay, so that was sort of the motivating example with a really small haplotypes, only of two loci. And now I want to show you some software demonstration. So the profiles here is available by the PERPS publication, and I wrapped them up as an R object and made them available on this link. So we can actually load that R object into R, so we have easier access to the data. So we first make a variable with the URL, and then we load in the dataset. And by running these two lines of code, we get an object called Y23. And then we find all the observations here where the population contains Germany. And then we can make our database by subsetting the entire database with the observations from Germany. So now our DB is a database of the German observations. And then we can make a database only of these two loci that I did before. The way I actually estimated the discrete Laplace models on the figures I showed before was by first loading sort of enabling the functions from the discrete Laplace disk lab mix package. And again, you first need to install the package. You only need to do that once. And every time you need to use the functions in the package, you need to put in library disk lab mix, stands for discrete Laplace mixture. And then what I do is to fit 10 discrete Laplace models, one with one ancestor, one with two ancestors, all the way up to 10 ancestors. And for each number of ancestors, I fit my model on this database with the two loci. And I use this K, so that's the number of ancestors going from 1 to 10. Notice that this L here, so 1L means that 1 is an integer and 10L is an integer. So that's some technical stuff with R. So when we have these 10 discrete Laplace models, we need to decide how good they are to pick the best one. And just like any other statistical method, the more parameters it has, the better it actually fits the data it was used to, that was used to estimate the parameters of the model. So it means that it is fitting better and better for in-sample data, so the data that was used to estimate the parameters with. But there is a risk of overfitting, meaning that if we get use a new observation, the model can be grossly wrong. So there's a trade-off between having a too complex model and also fitting well enough. And so there's a compromise between picking the number of parameters and getting a good model fit. And here we try to solve that compromise using the Bayesian information criterion, BIC. What it does is to say that we want the model to fit the data well, but we do not want to spend too many parameters doing it. And so we take here the best model to be the one with the minimal BIC. There are actually other options. We could also take a number of models, and we could do that to test the sensitivity. So does the predicted probability change a lot if we go from 9 to 8 ancestors, for example? We could also say that we want the top 3 or top 5 best models and then make a weighted combination, for example, weighted by the BIC values or inverse BIC values. Also note that I fitted the model from 1 to 10 ancestors, and I need to check whether the best model actually is on the edge of my range here. So I need to check if the best model actually has 10 ancestors, because then I need to extend the range, maybe going from 1 to 20 and then check it again. So in R code here, what I do is to extract the BIC value for each model. So I take my list of my discrete Laplace fits, and then I extract the BIC marginal slots here. So this one here is a numeric vector with all the BIC values. And then I take the model here in the model list with the minimal BIC value. And then I print that model. And as we see here, it's a model with 1692 observations on these two loci, and the best one has 9 clusters. So that's the resulting one I showed you previously on the slides. And then there are some technical information here. The number of ancestors can also be obtained here. So we can take this y dot is the profiles of the ancestors. And if I take the number of rows in that matrix, I get the number of ancestors. I can, of course, also print the profiles of the ancestors, and I extend that with tor. So that's the a priori probability of originating from each of these ancestors. So for example, ancestor number 3 here has profile 1413, so that's the red one up here. So there's an a priori probability of originating from that one of 32%. And then there are a number of other ancestors as well. And I can then, for example, use my model here and compute a probability for a new haplotype, for example, 14 and 8. So that's the singleton from the database here. And under that model, I get this probability. And I can compare that with the database frequency of 1 divided by 1692. And again, as I showed before, under the discrete Laplace model, it is actually a lot more rare than we would think based on the database. So if we consider partial, or maybe I should say here that the process is the same if you have more loci. Of course, it's difficult to plot the haplotypes, but you can still do all the other stuff by fitting the models and so on. And that's what I'm going to show you now. And I'll use an example based on partial profiles. So we imagine here that the German reference database has 7 loci that I list here. And notice that we exclude 385 AB, and that's mainly because it's duplicated, so we do not know where A and B are, meaning that if one person has 14 and 15, we are not sure whether the sort of that's the same as 15 and 14, because by convention the alleles are just ordered numerically. So there are some notation here that is difficult to model mathematically. In the databases, we have this locus called 389.2, and that locus actually contains 389.1, and I give a link here that shows that. So to extract that information, we make a new locus here, 389.2.1. So that's the original locus, but taken extracted that containing allele from it. So assume that we have Q, the person of interest, and then we assume that two loci were not available, namely 19 and 390. So we only have 5 loci, and the profile of Q I give here, so 13, 16, 10, 11, 13. And again, we're missing these 2 loci. So what we then do is to estimate a discrete Laplace model for the full reference database of these 7 loci, and then we marginalize out the unobserved loci. And I'll show you what I mean by this marginalize out. So that actually also means that we have our reference database, and then we make a discrete Laplace model based on that, and then we can actually use that fit to also calculate frequencies for partial profiles. So we estimate our model for the full 7 loci here, and we take from 1 to 30 ancestors. So this is the same functionality as before. Here we use lapply, and that means that in R, first it will fit a model with 1 ancestor, then it will fit a model with 2 ancestors, and so on. And you can actually do that in parallel. One option is to you do this, and there are several other options. And again, then we take the best model measured by the minimal BIC, and we see here that it actually has 17 ancestors. And again, it's not the endpoint in the range of number of possible ancestors. That was 1 to 30. So we stick with that, and there's no reason to extend that range. Now we need to prepare the marginalized out 2 loci. And these are the 2 missing loci. So in the database, we see that the minimal allele observed at 19 was 11 and the maximal was 18. And for 390, it was 19 and 27. We also know that there may exist alleles in the population that were not observed in the database. And here I chose that I want to go on either side, plus minus 4. So I have reason to believe that there may exist alleles out in the population that is 4 less or 4 bigger than what was observed in the database. So this is some R code to generate these alleles. So that means that the 19 locus here is not going from 11 to 18 as was observed in the database, but I instead say that it could actually potentially go from 7 to 22. So 7 comes from 11 minus 4 to 18 plus 4, that's 22, and the same goes for 390. So these are the possible alleles, and we need to consider all combinations of these alleles, and that's what I mean by marginalizing out. We need to take, what if our person of interest had 7, 15, 7, 16, 7, 17, and so on, 8, 15, 8, 16, and all the way up. So all possible combinations of these unobserved alleles. That's what I mean by marginalizing out. So we take the profile of the person of interest and then the alleles that I calculated from before. And then we use an argument called expand grid on this list of the alleles. And what it does is creating a Cartesian product. So it takes all the allele combinations. And then I reorder the columns to be sure that it's actually in the same order as my database. And I actually get 272 haplotypes. So my person of interest, I do not know which of these 272 possible combinations of the unobserved alleles Q has. So what I do is to take the probability for all these 272 profiles and sum them together. That is what I mean by marginalizing out. So here I just show the two first and two last rows. So here you see that the observed loci are fixed here. And so 319 is variable, and also 390 is variable, and the other ones are fixed. So 272 is what you get by obtaining all the unobserved alleles, or the alleles at the unobserved loci, I should say. And then we use our model on all these possible haplotypes, and then we take the sum of all these probabilities, and then we obtain a bit above 5%. So here we say that the discrete Laplace frequency for this partial profile is a bit above 5%. We can also compare that number with the observed one in the database. And to do that, I use the tidyverse library. And again, I type in library tidyverse to enable the functions from that package. And if you do not have that package installed already, you need to first install it by that command. And I take the database, and then so that's a matrix, and then I convert it to a tuple to be able to filter out. So I take all the rows that matches my partial profile, and then I simply count how many observations are there that matches my partial profile, and there are 103 in the database. And then I compare that, so that frequency with the relative frequency. So the partial profile is observed 6% in the database. And again, under the discrete Laplace model, it's a bit above 5%. So they seem to agree pretty well. Then one or several would ask, should we use the discrete Laplace method, or what I call here the Milan method? That was the method introduced in Why webinar number one. So the new method by David Balding and I that we published in 2017. So we would like to say that the discrete Laplace method complements our new method. And it is complementing in the sense that when the number of loci, and hence the combined mutation rate, increase, then the Milan method becomes more advantageous. Whereas when the combined mutation rate is low, so there are a few loci, then the discrete Laplace method has advantages. So for new, for example, 27 marker kits like YFiler Plus, we would recommend using our new method here that I refer to as the Milan method, our 2017 method. Whereas if we have only a few number of loci, say 5 or 7, or maybe a bit more, then you would use the discrete Laplace method. We probably also need to make a few notes on the applicability of the discrete Laplace method. So we recommend to use it only when you have decided to actually report the evidential weight as using match probabilities. And please see the discussion in Why webinar number one. It is not straightforward that is the right choice to do. Also note that we need a low mutation rate. And again, as David explained in Why webinar number one, that is because the Y haplotypes are clustered. And another way to think of it is whether the Y haplotypes are scattered evenly around the population or not. And if there are few loci, then they are approximately evenly scattered, and if there are many loci, they are not evenly scattered. Then there is a technical issue or a statistical issue with the discrete Laplace method. We cannot handle it if there are too many loci. So one option is maybe to say up to 10 loci, for example. We do not have a hard bound here on these 10 loci. It really depends on how many loci, what loci there are, how many alleles are observed, and so on. The technical or statistical issue arising with many loci is because it is very difficult to estimate the profile of the ancestors if there is many loci or if we are in a high dimensional space. And it is due to what is called or referred to as the curse of dimensionality. And that's actually because distance is getting weird or behaves strange in high dimensions. And there's I found a quote here from Pedro Domingos at the University of Washington in USA. And there's one way of understanding it intuitively is that most of the volume of a high dimensional orange is in the skin, not in the pulp. And that's very different from what we actually have in low dimensional spaces. So it also means that distances in high dimensional spaces are very difficult, and basically more or less all distances are large in high dimensional spaces. And also, as I mentioned before, the database must be representative of the population. Also note that the discrete Laplace method can only handle integer alleles. So we do not handle partial repeats. So for example, allele 10.2. But there are other methods that can handle that, and I give two references for that here. And again, I give the details in the last slide. Again, this was talk 4 out of 5 in this series of Why webinars, and the 4 others are listed here. And again, we recommend that Why webinar 1 is viewed first, and then any of the others can be viewed in any order. So here is the list of the references. The first one here is the software paper for the DiscRapBix software. So if you use that, you can look at the code here, and it also contains a copy of the software if GitHub is to be moved or whatever. There's a 2020 paper and also a 2018 paper with two different ways to estimate haplotype frequencies, and those are based on graphical models. That is joint work together with the authors you see here. Then there is one first here, and an application of the discrete Laplace method on mixtures. A general introduction to the discrete Laplace method that I think is makes it easier to read this original 2013 paper that actually publish or gives the statistical details of the method, and also an application of the method in terms of cluster analysis. And then the data was published in this 2014 paper, where the data and all the haplotypes is available as supplementary data. But again, as I mentioned, I wrapped them up in an R object, so we can load it easier into R instead of having to load in the Excel files. Thank you for listening, and I hope to hear from you in the comment or in the discussion feed.